Okay, see, now what separates me, okay, from like Hollywood directors, okay, is that I have a huge head, all right, okay? Now I don't mean I have a big ego, okay, because I don't, all right? I mean my actual head is huge, all right? I mean, I have to sleep sitting up, okay? Like the Elephant Man, or I'll die, all right?
But Festival.
So interested in big man's wife.
But okay, get this though, okay? It was my huge head, okay, that thought up who was perfect to play Marcellus's wife, all right?
Quentin Tarantino is speaking out for the first time about Uma Thurman's claim that when she was starring in Kill Bill, Tarantino insisted she drive this blue convertible instead of a stunt person, even though she says she told him she thought the car was broken. Thurman says the accident left her neck permanently damaged, calling the experience dehumanizing to the point of death. Tarantino tells Deadline Hollywood that the decision to put his star behind the wheel was heartbreaking, beyond one of the biggest regrets of my career. It is one of the biggest regrets of my life. Check out this split screen, the final film cut on the left, the raw material on the right. Watch as Thurman appears to struggle, losing control of the car, crashing off the side of the road, immediately clutching her head. The crew, including Tarantino, rushing to the scene. Tarantino says he test drove the route ahead of time and thought, it was just a straight shot. I was very happy thinking she can totally do this. It won't be a problem. Uma's response was, okay, because she believed me, because she trusted me. He says, I didn't force her into the car. She got into it because she trusted me. Thurman opened up to New York Times columnist Maureen Dowd about the toxic environment she says she experienced as a woman in Hollywood, especially in the Miramax universe where director Quentin Tarantino and Harvey Weinstein reigned supreme. Thurman says Weinstein tried to force himself on her in his hotel room in London. He pushed me down. He tried to shove himself on me. He tried to expose himself. She says she later met with Weinstein to confront him, telling him, if you do what you did to me to other people, you will lose your career. Weinstein admits to making an awkward pass at Thurman once, but denies he ever assaulted her. Tarantino says he became aware of Weinstein's predatory behavior after his girlfriend at the time, Mira Sorvino, experienced it firsthand. Shortly after Sorvino confided in him, Thurman told Tarantino Weinstein also attacked her. While we were getting ready to do Kill Bill, Uma tells me that he had done the same thing to her. That's when I realized there was a pattern in Harvey's luring and pushing attacks.
Now, what do you think about Spike Lee saying that Quentin Tarantino is wrong for using the N-word 110 times?
When I see Quentin Tarantino, I'm going to take this fist and I'm going to put it right in his mouth where he say
I can't speak in it because I'm not going to see it. I'm not seeing it. I think for me, the only thing I'm gonna say is it'd be disrespectful to my ancestors to see that film. And that's the only thing I'm gonna say. I can't disrespect my ancestors. Can't do it. Can't do it. Now, that's me. I'm not speaking on behalf of anybody but myself.
It's real deal. You're really
real
upset
deal.
About that.
I'm not upset about it. I didn't say nothing about emotion. Emotion would mean I'm emotional.
Yeah.
See, the whole thing is he thinks for some reason he can say, there go my artist right there. What up, young cat?
What's up, man? What's up, Big Pimp?
Okay. All right, hold on.
Yeah.
So anyway, Quentin Tarantino think he can say the N-word, but I checked with all of and nobody knows where he got his pass from. I hope he didn't get it from Samuel L. Jackson and Jamie Foxx, because they not going to help you when I see you.
But you know what's on my mind right now? It ain't the coffee in my kitchen. It's the dead nigger in my garage.
Okay, all right.
I'm saying that's disrespectful. I don't call Spanish people because it's disrespectful. Who would do that, let alone do it 186 times in a movie for profit? Like, for real? And put it out on Jesus' birthday? Really? You better unchain Django. I'm trying to figure out how you had a silent letter before could read.
Now.
Listen to what I just said. How could you have a silent letter before black people could read?
How could you have...
You can pull it in here. Did you notice a sign on the front of my house that said dead nigger storage?
Jimmy, you know I ain't seen no shit.
Did you notice a sign in the front of my house that said dead nigger storage?
People are saying is that he made a movie about slavery, right? And a lot of people are upset about that. Now, Steven Spielberg made a movie about slavery with Amistad.
Quentin Tarantino is no Steven Spielberg. Mm-hmm. Steven Spielberg doesn't want to be black. Quentin Tarantino thinks he is.
Okay.
So when he meets a real, we'll see if he is or not.
I knew enough to do more than I did. Such a simple yet explosive statement. Welcome to Access Hollywood. No director in Hollywood has been more closely associated with Harvey Weinstein than Quentin Tarantino.
Yeah, I think.
I wish I had taken responsibility for what I heard, so says Tarantino, admitting to the New York Times that he knew about Weinstein's alleged harassments and assaults long before the accusers came forward. There was more to it than just the normal rumors, the normal gossip. It wasn't secondhand. I knew he did a couple of these things. Yet over the years, Tarantino continued to make film after film with Weinstein, a decision he now regrets.
My guy at Miramax is Harvey Weinstein. You know, him and Bob, they're my guy. They love my stuff. I mean, they're probably my biggest fan.
Let me tell you what Like a Virgin's about. It's all about a girl who digs a guy with a big dick. The entire song, it's a metaphor for big dicks.
No, it ain't. It's about a girl who's very vulnerable. She's been fucked over a few times, and then she meets a guy who's
Whoa. Time out, Green Bay. Tell that fucking bullshit to the tourists.
Toby? Who the fuck is Toby?
Like a Virgin's not about some sensitive girl who meets a nice fella. That's what True Blue's about. No, granted, no argument about that.
Which one's True Blue?
Hey, what the fuck was I talking about?
So True Blue was about a guy, sensitive girl who meets a nice guy, but Like a Virgin was a metaphor for big dicks.
Okay, let me tell you what Like a Virgin's about. It's all about this Coos, who's a regular fuck machine. I'm talking morning, day, night, afternoon. Dick, 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 dick.
How many dicks is that?
A lot. Then one day, she meets this John Holmes motherfucker, and it's like, whoa, baby. I mean, this cat is like Charles Bronson in The Great Escape. He's digging tunnels. All right, now she's getting this serious dick action. And she's feeling something she ain't felt since forever. Pain. Pain.
Chew, Toby, chew.
It hurts. It hurts her. It shouldn't hurt. You know, her pussy should be bubbling up by now. But when this cat fucks her, it hurts. It hurts just like it did the first time. You see, the pain is reminding a fuck machine what it was once like to be a virgin. Hence, Like a Virgin.
Getting specific, Quentin told The Times how shocked he was when his then-girlfriend, now Weinstein accuser Mira Sorvino, whom Quentin dated in 1995, told him about what she claimed were unwanted advances and touching by Harvey. Tarantino also knew Rose McGowan, who has accused Weinstein of rape, had reached a settlement with the man. Tarantino said, quote, "What I did was marginalize the incidents. Anything I say now will sound like a crappy excuse."
Okay, Walter, your character, okay, is the gift. Okay? Now, what you have to remember about your character is that he's, you know, he's like, okay, he's kept in a trunk, all right? In the basement of some guy's house, okay? And he's used for deviant, hardcore gay sex, okay?
Let's do it.
Exactly. Right, you got to explain this. I've been dying to get a hold of you for this reason. When you, Gary Garver, our reporter out in Hollywood, interviewed you, here's what you said. I got to ask you about this.
Okay.
This I don't understand. Your movie, I understand. Mm-hmm. This I don't. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go.
Hey, Quentin, how you doing, man?
Hey.
How's it going, man?
Pretty good.
Nice to meet you. What have you done to make the world a better place?
I don't know. What do you think I've done?
Cool movies.
I'll stand with that.
Pulp Fiction's awesome.
Yeah.
Hey, were you happy when Roman Polanski won the Oscar?
Yeah, that was pretty cool, actually, yeah.
What's so great about a rapist being the recipient of Hollywood's highest honor?
I don't consider him a rapist.
Right, that's the one. How can you defend? See, I don't understand this. Mm-hmm. How come Hollywood embraces this madman, this director who raped a 13-year-old?
And the Oscar goes to Roman Polanski for The Pianist.
He didn't rape a 13-year-old. It was statutory rape.
Yeah, all right.
Well,
that's not quite the same thing. All
come
right?
on.
Enough said.
It's not statutory rape. You know, he had sex with a minor.
All right, that's not rape. To me, when you use the word rape, all right, you're talking about violent, throwing them down. It's like one of the most violent crimes in the world. You can't throw, you know, throwing the word rape around is like throwing the word racist around. All
okay,
right, you know,
okay.
It just doesn't apply to everything that people use it for. All right,
but
you know, he was guilty of having sex with a minor. All right?
That she didn't want to have.
No, that was not the case at all. She wanted to have it.
Well,
dated the guy, and found out. Well, and by the way, we're talking about America's morals. We're not talking about the morals in Europe and everything.
Wait a second. More than Europe, more than China. With a 13-year-old girl, and you're a grown man.
Uh-huh.
You know that that's wrong because
she's giving her booze and pills.
I'm not. Look. She was down with it.
Oh, you're crazy.
And she's talked about it. She's talked about it.
Okay.
In 2003, Tarantino defended fellow director Roman Polanski, who pled guilty to unlawful sex with a 13-year-old in 1977. The victim said she was drugged and raped.
Crazy.
I'm right. She's talked about it since. He didn't really do anything to me. Though it was a technicality of her being 13.
In this radio interview, Tarantino repeatedly appears to fault Polanski's young victim.
I don't care what Quentin Tarantino thinks. I know what the truth is. He was wrong.
54-year-old Samantha Geimer was just 13 when Roman Polanski offered to take these photos of her for a modeling shoot. About 3 weeks later, she says the then 43-year-old Polanski gave her alcohol and a Quaalude before raping her.
Would you ever seduce a 13-year-old with pills and booze?
No.
I can't get out of bed. Bones are aching.
Again, you're killing him with the pills and booze.
Why?
Right?
But it's true.
But no more than if she was 18 or 19 or 20.
I'm
going to
read the transcript.
Let's refute this.
Oh, wait a minute. No, the transcripts are like now she's trying to take care of her mom who's pissed off at her. So now she's saying this, she's saying that. Now that she's an adult.
About? This was when it happened.
I know that's what I'm saying. Her mom is now on her. Now she has to say he did this, he did that. Now she's an adult. She said a whole different story.
What did Mr. Polanski say? He said, yeah, I'll take you home soon. What did you do? I told him, I said that I wanted to go home. What did Mr. Polanski say? He told me to go in the other room and lie down. I was going, no. I better go home because I was afraid. So I went and I sat down on the couch. And what were you afraid of him? Him? See?
And what was the answer?
Oh, then they just go him. I don't know. That was weird.
That was a very provocative question with no answer.
What happened when you sat down on the couch? He sat down beside me and asked me if I was okay. I said no. What happened then? He reached over and he kissed me and I was telling him no. You know, keep away. He said, I'll take you home soon. Then what happened? And then he went down and he started performing cuddliness.
Uh-huh.
13, cuddliness.
Okay, now let me talk for a second here.
She didn't even know what the word cuddliness is.
People have been saying what he said and worse since I was 13. So I've always had to deal with it.
Okay, now let me now
go
talk.
Ahead.
If you were gonna,
Do you know Roman Polanski?
Oh, I've met him once, but he's not a friend or anything.
All right.
Now, if you were going to really do equal time, then you could have his book, Roman by Polanski, and read his chapter about what he says happens.
Well, of course he's going to say she was into it.
And, of course, she's going to say this because she knows she was in trouble with her mom.
So why do you side with him?
Because his version sounds more likely. Sounds really, really more likely. She was not.
You know how he could have avoided all this? Not being with a 13-year-old.
He likes girls.
Hold on. This is the way I always put it in perspective with guys.
I know what you're going to say.
I'm not doing it.
If
you had a 13-year-old daughter, the most mature 13-year-old in the world, she looks 17, and your 13-year-old daughter, you leave her alone with a guy who's supposed to photograph her, who's 25 or 30, and you find out that he had cuddliness with her, you'd freak, wouldn't you?
No. Yes.
He had intercourse with
her.
There'd be a bullet in Polanski's head.
Yes.
I'd kill him. You'd kill him.
I'd beat the hell out of him.
Right.
All right.
Within an inch of his life.
Yeah, I'd beat the hell out of him. But
But the situation was not that she was against all this. She was down to party with Roman.
It is against the law. Let's get right down to it. The adult is supposed to know better.
Okay. But let's talk about it the way it is. She was down with the party. He was down with the party. But she was 13.
She doesn't get to say she's down with the party. She can't sign a contract. She can't rent an apartment. She can't do anything. She has to get her parents' permission for everything she wants to do.
At 13,
I know.
Could not make the decision.
But now we're not talking about rape anymore. We're not talking about
doing it against her will.
Right.
It's rape.
No, we're not.
Yes. Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
No, you're talking about, no, it's a minor situation. It's a situation that she's a minor.
It's rape.
That is the situation.
He should have done jail
time. Is it against the law? You're right.
He should have done jail time.
Well, you know, in this book, though, do you know what happened?
I will never let him come back into this country. I won't. He's not coming into the country.
Yes, I'm Batman.
He's not coming into the country.
Now, in his book, do you
laugh at me?
In his book, yeah. He talks about why he split.
Why do you like him so much? Why do you think? Because he's a director?
You know, I've read the book.
You're
so
a director,
actually,
he's a director. Is that what's going on here?
I have a little bit of information on this, all right, as opposed to just popping off on this and that and the other.
Any time a person's 13 mm-hmm. and an adult has sex with them, I believe that's rape.
Look, okay, I don't believe that's rape. I believe it's against the law.
Right.
All right?
I believe it's rape.
I don't believe it's rape. I mean, not at 13. Not for these 13-year-old party girls out there.
Oh, my.
Really?
13-year-old party girls. What is that?
Hey, let me ask you. All right, so you did.
Couldn't you have found an 18-year-old party
girl? When did you guys turn into Bill O'Reilly? Bill O'Reilly. I wasn't looking, all right?
Wait a second. I have a daughter who is 11.
Uh-huh.
She is such a little girl.
Mm-hmm.
And even I have a daughter, 17, who, while she is old enough, certainly, you know, you still see that youthful innocence. I've had three daughters. I know what it is to have a 13-year-old daughter.
Mm-hmm.
There is no way emotionally they're equipped to run off with a 40-year-old a Roman Polanski
mm-hmm.
and have him say, come on, baby, let's drink, let's take some pills. And I say, it's up to Roman Polanski to go, you know what, you're really young. And you know what, maybe this is insane, I have an attraction for you, but you've got to go home.
Yeah, look, okay, now, in this situation, I agree with you.
Right.
I agree with you. The only thing I'm having a problem with is using super big buzzwords that don't quite apply to the situation when you say that word and what you imagine.
You've got to get off the ecstasy and listen to me.
I think what surprised me was just how cavalier Tarantino was being, and I think we definitely see the hypocrisy in this apologia that's happening now.
Quentin Tarantino.
All right, okay.
I hate your stinking guts.
Okay.
You make me vomit.
Okay.
The scum between my toes.
Geimer says she's heartened that more people are listening to victims in the wake of the Me Too movement.
I think Me Too is a good thing where we could, like, have solidarity for each other. The shoe's a bit on the other foot now, where I'm shown sympathy and Roman's the monster.
Now, I don't mean I have a big ego, okay, because I don't, all right? I mean, my actual head is huge, all right? I mean, I have to sleep sitting up, okay? Like the Elephant Man, or I'll die, all right?